92.1 WROI, WROIFM.com, streaming audio live, RTC Channel 5. Audio and video soon to be on RTC Channel 4. That's why JC's with us. Hey, how are you? Yeah, nice to have you back in the studio. And, of course, across the way from me, Mr. John Alley, President, CEO, Woodlawn Hospital.
Good morning, John. Morning. Good morning.
Nice to have you with us again.
You know, it's kind of the weather starting to get a little nicer out there. Yeah. No jackets today. No. You know, it's just going bold. No jacket.
Put the top down on the convertible?
I don't have one.
Okay, I don't know. You got any fishermen out there at the pond?
We've had quite a few fishermen at the pond, yes. It's so that's kind of the first sign of spring. The second one, you know, we try to get the fountain put in. Come find out last fall, we kind of had an electrical glitch, and they had to replace some wiring under the road. Well, it burnt the motor out of the pond.
Oh, no.
Fountain. So we got a new motor ordered.
Okay.
So hopefully next couple weeks, the fountain will be operational.
Excellent.
That's the first sign of spring.
I think it is, too. And that the walking path crowds up a little bit. Folks walking around Woodlawn out there. So that's good to see.
You know, warming up, we're seeing more people walking and... you know, like I say, get the fountain going, and then sure sign of fall is when we take the fountain out. So
we'll remember that.
That's our barometer
of
when the seasons are. Yes.
All right. Trustees were meeting yesterday.
Yeah, had another fairly short meeting. Not a lot of action that they needed to work on. Probably the most important thing is Mike Perdue, who's our director of plant operations, needs to replace his mower. And as you can imagine, we put quite a few hours on a mower out there. It runs 5 days a week, 6 hours a day. So the one we had was just getting to the point that we knew it was going to cost more to maintain it than to replace it. So he got several quotes, and they were all presented to the board. And they did decide to go with a grasshopper this year is what the board picked. And, you know, from Rochester, New Holland. And Mr. Strader, because of his financial interest in that, did abstain from any of the discussion of voting on that, which is the right thing to do. Just keeps him kind of out of that loop. But we just decided we wanted to keep it local. For any maintenance or anything, somebody local will do it. So that was approved yesterday. So that paperwork should go through. Hopefully next week or two, we'll have the new mower. And, our groundskeeper is back from Florida. He spends the winter down there. He's not happy. He's been wearing his Carhartts. It's a little colder than what he would like for it to be. So we're hoping to get some nice weather and he start getting the grounds cleaned up for us again.
Excellent.
Also, we're scheduling for next month. Our auditors will be in to present the 2000 audit findings to the board. The preliminary draft copy went out to the board, I think, yesterday. So they'll have like a month to be able to look at it. Then they'll come in, answer any questions, and then do the presentation, you know, the formal presentation to the board at that next month's meeting. Went into our financial statements for the month of March. We had a gross revenue of $13.5 million. Our deductions from revenue was $8.4 million. Operating expenses, about $5 million. So we actually was able to post a profit for the month of March of $393,000. So, you know, it's a good start to the year. Usually early on in the year is when we kind of have our fairly large losses. As we move through the fall of the year, we start making that up. So it's nice to kind of start that slow time that we know is coming as we get into the summer months, you know, being in the black, so to speak, for the hospital.
Do you attribute that to anything in particular, John?
We just had a little higher volumes than what we anticipated.
Okay.
And we try to go back when we look at our budgets, historically, how many people have we seen, you know, who's come in? And so you kind of tweak that a little bit and say, well, what we did last year is probably what we're going to do next year. And we just see this year a little higher volumes. I think the flu was a lot worse this year than it was last year. The flu vaccine just didn't quite catch it. So we had a lot of inpatients come in with those flu-like symptoms. So that kind of put us over budget in the revenue. And we were able to then also then contain the expenses so as, you know, not eat that revenue and expenses. So I think that's probably the biggest things why we're at this point of this year, we do have a positive bottom line. It's nice to have some, you know, a little bit of a, you know, cash in the bank, so to speak, or, you know, the hidden funds out there that as we go into the slow time to offset some of the months that we know we're going to be seeing some losses. And we actually budget losses for the summer months, just knowing that the volumes are going to be down. But again, we have to maintain X number of people no matter what in the hospital. Mm-hmm. We have minimum staffing. So even though we might not have any patients, I still have to keep a fairly large complement of staff in the hospital just in case somebody would come in. So it's kind of nice to have a little bit of a cushion that we're working on right now.
Is the flu over?
Pretty well. I think we're on the downside
okay.
of that. You know, it was probably, I think last month, we actually pulled the visitation restrictions up.
Okay.
Again, we base that on the CDC guidelines. And when we look at a number of cases per 1,000 population, and when it's a certain level, then we put those restrictions in just for the patient's protection and the visitors, you know, because the virus is out there and we try to keep folks as safe as we can. So we lifted that about 30 days ago, and we haven't seen a whole lot of it. Do we still have a few come in? Yeah, but I think it's to the point now that we're kind of past that main flu time. Now we're getting in now the summer injuries. So when folks get out and start doing the yard work, with bruises and strains and stuff that happens when more senior folks like myself go out and try
to
do work in one day, and all of a sudden, something hurts the next day right. After we do that. So flu's kind of behind us at this point. The only other thing we kind of discussed with the board a little bit, Dave Colger, who's been in here a few times when I haven't been able to come in, our CFO.
Yes, he has.
He's going to be retiring on May 11th. He's been with us for 12 years and been a very valuable asset to the hospital, and he's going to be missed. So, everybody's kind of going in. He's on his countdown. He's got his calendar. He's counting down the days. So everybody's been wishing him well for his retirement. He did tell us that on one of the holes at the golf course that kind of backs up to the hospital, he's going to put a mailbox there. As he goes by, he's going to check it if we have any questions for him for a while.
That sounds like Dave.
Yeah, so wish him well, and I think he's going to have fun in retirement, spend a lot of time on the golf course.
But you've got a new guy also in place for quite a while.
Yeah, John Kraft. He's been in for a while, right. And it was kind of nice to be able to find him early in the process to be able to sit with Dave and kind of learn our system and how we do things. So then when Dave finally does leave on that May 11th, it's going to be a fairly easy transition for John, just to, we'll move him across the hall into Dave's office and hit the ground running.
Okay.
So he doesn't have that, anytime you take a new job, there's that long learning period. So we're past that.
Especially in hospitals,
yep. Because we all do things just a little bit differently. We have different software systems. So it's been very nice to have him on board now to learn all that, get acquainted with the staff. So, again, when he takes over as CFO, it's going to be a very smooth, I think, seamless transition, because he's been here for almost a year now.
So, exactly.
Yeah, it was kind of a good find when we first started the search that, usually it takes quite a while to find somebody, and he kind of popped up real quick. Was from the area, so it's not like he didn't know what he was getting into.
Right.
So it's been good having him in there. Dave's going to be missed, and he's having fun with his last few days.
He's
got his countdown calendar, so he's been sharing little gems of wisdom each day with a different person, which is kind of nice.
It is indeed.
And that's pretty well the board meeting. Not a lot went on.
Okay, we're getting ready to head into the spring months, late spring months with May, and then into the summer months. Anything on the agenda for Woodlawn Hospital? Anything that you're planning now to take a look at or to do, let's say, coming up?
Yeah, I think probably the biggest thing that we're going to start that process again, we talked about it a little bit, is the renovation of some of the patient rooms. It was put on hold about 5-6 years ago because, I wanted us to have funds set aside so that I didn't have to borrow money to do this renovation. So we've kind of called the architects and said, hey, can you get those plans out? Let's dust them off. Let's see where we're at on that. I'm guessing there's going to be some changes from 5 years ago when we first looked at it, just because the regulations change. And so whatever those are, we'll have to update those plans.
Cost change, too.
Cost. Sure. I'm guessing the cost has gone up quite a bit. So, we're going to start that process. Right now, I would like for us to see if we can't get that renovation started third quarter 2019.
Okay.
Because it's going to take a while, I think, to get everything in place. And it's not going to be just a short renovation, because if we're going to redo all the rooms, I can only do about 3 at a time. So we'll take 3 out of service. So it could be, 60, 90 days that those 3 rooms out of service, put them back, take another 3 rooms out. So when you start looking across the number of rooms we have, that could be a couple years before that whole project would be completed.
Will you keep the same number of rooms?
Right now, yes. We're looking at an option would be the east side of that second floor. There's some six rooms that overlook the green roof. One of the thoughts was to take those 6 rooms and turn them into 4, make them slightly larger so the orthopedic patients, because there's a lot more of equipment in a room with an orthopedic patient just, for the rehab. So we're kind of thinking that's probably the route we want to go. I've got to look and make sure that doesn't hurt us long term. And I've got 2 rooms now that I've had before for patients that I don't have. So we've got to look at trends and make sure that I'm not going to be, kind of cutting my nose off to spite my face by taking 2 rooms out of service. Right now, I'm probably about 75% sure that's what I want to do is to turn those 6 into 4. And, once I get the architects in, get the experts in, let's look at the structure. Can we even do it with those rooms? Not sure how they're an integral part of that building, and I might not be able to do that. So that's part of why I think it's going to take me at least a year to get the plans done, look at the building, look at the structure, what can we change? You know, there's you can't take out a support wall or anything. So I think that's going to be part of that process to get it ready to go and then start that third quarter 19 to start some room renovations.
How long has it been?
Those are the original rooms.
Okay.
When the hospital was built. They have served us very well. Back when the hospital was built, we was kind of the leader. Nobody had all private rooms, and you know, which we've always had. And we're going to keep that. So it's time. Technology has changed substantially from, you know, 15, 20 years ago. So the demands in a room is much greater now. We have more equipment in there that they never had, never dreamed to have when that building was built. So we've got to change it to meet the new demands. And the architect's very good. They can come in and, right. You know, we can't make more space, but we can make it more friendly, better utilize the space we've got. And that's going to be the challenge when we design these rooms is how can we make them very efficient for staff, very comfortable for patients and family.
I'd make a suggestion that maybe you contact HGTV, you could do hospital fixer-upper.
I hadn't thought of that. my guess is that would cost me more than if we just go the traditional route.
It probably would.
Yeah. But yeah, maybe we get some TV ratings out of this. Who knows?
John, altogether, and of course we've talked about this on several different occasions too, but it's the people that make Woodlawn Hospital successful and make it go.
Oh, absolutely. You know, and I've said it before, the staff out there makes my job extremely easy. Long time ago when I was in college, a professor told me, he says, if you surround yourself with great individuals, they'll make you look really good. And I have to, you know, we've got an outstanding workforce at the hospital. Not only are they very good at what they do, they're very caring. And I think that is, to me, is an integral part of the whole healing process, that if the atmosphere is upbeat, you're going to get well quicker than if you're in, you know, everybody's gloomy, then you're going to be gloomy. So the staff works very hard at doing that. That's part of our orientation when we bring new folks in. Here's our expectation of how you interact with staff, with patients and visitors, their family. And, when you consider most of our staff works 12-hour shifts, they spend more time in the hospital than they do waking hours with their own family.
Right.
So we're their family, and we got to treat them like that. And like families, do we argue? Absolutely. but I think overall, the atmosphere out there is very conducive to the healing process. It's very friendly, cordial. I get a lot of compliments from visitors who come in. Say, I walked through your building, and I had 20 people tell me hi. Or ask me if they could help me. That's what I expect. You know, it's traumatic to come to a hospital as a patient or a visitor. If you're a visitor, you've got a loved one in there that's sick. We've got to ease that tension, make it not quite so traumatic for them. And I think the staff does an excellent job on doing that.
24/7, too.
24/7. The doors are always open.
Exactly. John Alley, President and CEO of Woodlawn Hospital. Take a look at May. Any particular agenda items that might be cropping up then?
I don't think so. Okay. I mean, again, other than probably the biggest thing for the board meeting is going to be the audit report. And as a small hospital, the audit standards like segregation of duties. We don't have enough staff to segregate. So every year we kind of get that same suggestion, you know, you need to, you know, have more people do this. And it would be nice, but I don't have the people.
Right.
And, it's a small enough organization. We've got probably, I think, a very good checks and balances within our system. So the auditors say, yeah, we told you this last year. We're going to tell you this again this year. And we'll probably tell you this next year. And they realize that we just don't have the infrastructure or the ability to create a lot of jobs to give them the separation that they would like to see. Is it something I worry about? No. I think we have enough checks and balances in place, but they have audit standards that they have to meet. And, you know, if we're not quite there, we're darn close, though.
But you still employ a lot of people, John.
We still employ a lot of people. I think if right now we've probably got around 400 total people employed, either full-time, part-time, or what we call PRN, which is another integral part of our workforce. That's those who basically we can call and say, hey, can you come work tomorrow because somebody's sick? And they, yeah, I'll come in. They might have a full-time job somewhere else, but they're willing to come in on a day off if we need them and fill that slot. And, that's very important for us because, you know, we need to have X number of bodies every day. And if somebody, you know, unfortunately gets sick or can't come in, we got to try to find somebody. And these folks do it on a very short notice, and we really appreciate that.
John Alley, President and CEO of Woodlawn Hospital. Keep up keeping the community healthy, will you please?
Our job is to put ourselves out of business if we can make everybody healthy.
John Alley, thanks very much.
Thank you.